Let me also say good morning and welcome everyone this morning.
Good morning.
Couple things before I start. Trying to play around with some of this audio stuff. Brother Chike trying to alert me a little bit. So if I mess up, don't blame it on Chike. It's just the fact I'm a slow learner. But we're going to be dealing with Psalms this morning. And in dealing with Psalms, I know Shingai is anxious to get up here and do his lesson. So I'm going to take these 150 chapters and do it in one Sunday morning. We're going to be doing some reading this morning, and I'd like to have someone start off by reading the introduction that's in your bulletin.
The Book of Psalms is a collection of hymns used in the worship at the temple. They can be categorized into five areas. The most distinguishable songs include songs of praise, songs of thanksgiving, songs of entreaty, songs of wisdom, songs of law. Well, the 150 chapters cover a span of several centuries as it regards the history of the black nation Israel.
Well,
a number of songs are considered to be royal songs to King David and his successors, and as time went on, became the focus of a messianic hope tradition.
Okay, thank you. As we get, before we get into Psalms, I want to just kind of go back and talk about David, since he's like a key figure in Psalms. He's attributed to a lot of the books and writings in Psalms. So let's, first of all, get a little history about David and what was taking place in his life. If you read the contents in Psalms, it would not be hard to picture a writer who is humble and grateful. You could envision an individual that some would call pious based on deep admiration given to the power of God. The poetry of love shown to God and the protection given by God, one would think that there was not a mean streak in the writer's body. But that is not David. David, on the other hand, was a fighter, a liberator, a national hero to the black nation Israel.
Well,
and here's a little of his story. Samuel the prophet was looking for the next leader of the black nation Israel, per God's instruction. He is led to the house of Jesse.
Mm-hmm.
While there, Samuel reviewed seven of Jesse's eight sons. None of them fit the bill. They had the look of leadership, but they weren't leadership. Stately in nature and built warrior-like, they seemed to be valiant. They were all rejected by Samuel. Leadership is more than good looks. Leadership is more than looking the part. Leadership is not superficial.
Well,
Samuel inquired about the eighth son, David, and he was out watching sheep. Jesse had him come into the fields to meet with Samuel. Samuel, as the story goes, is told by God to anoint David, and Samuel breaks the news to Saul in 1 Samuel 13:14, and it reads as follows. Yahweh has searched out a man for himself after his own heart, and designated him leader of his people, since you have not carried out what God ordered you to do.
Well,
to lead, one must uphold the message and mission. One must be true to the heart of God's plan.
Well,
as we have seen time and time again, straying from the law, not following the covenant, left the nation Israel in turmoil and usually subjugation at the hands of others.
Right.
It is David's commitment to the law that attracts Samuel to anointing him as the future king. One who will bring in strong, in one who will be strong in times of turmoil,
wow,
to stay the course, attack the challenges on freedom's road.
Mm-hmm.
Leadership calls for the ability to not be sidetracked by others. Leadership must have faith that the established principles and beliefs of one's own culture are self-sustaining and uncompromising. Leadership is standing face to face with the Goliaths of the world. In our studies since we began in Genesis, the following message has been continuous. Leadership that followed the covenant eventually brought the nation Israel back to a point of power and influence over the direction of their fate.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't always last. Jerusalem, historians tell us, was conquered almost 40 times in the course of 3,000 years.
My Lord.
That's less than 100 years straight of controlling their destiny at any point in time. Mm-hmm. Needless to say, over the course of those thousands of years, there was strong leadership and weak leadership. Even during strong leadership, there were constant battles to hold it together. In times of weak leadership, trying to maintain the covenant relationship with God was borderline total chaos and disintegration of the nation.
Mm-hmm.
What brought the nation Israel back from the brink of complete disaster was that regardless of who the leader was, good, and especially if it was bad, there were always a few that stood fast and insisted on the covenant law being upheld.
Well,
the judges, the prophets, members of the black nation that just knew to do right.
Mm-hmm.
Contrary to traditional Christian thinking, God's plan does not always go as planned.
Well,
and you know that old phrase that the traditional Christian church uses when they don't really have an answer for you, thing or troubling you. They say, just don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. He may not be there when you want him.
Uh-huh.
Well, but good God Almighty, whenever he comes, be right on time. You tell that to the hundreds of thousands that died during the Middle Passage.
My Lord.
Can I get someone to read for me 1 Samuel 15, 10, and 11?
Is that 1 Samuel, Psalms?
What did I say? I said Samuel. Let me read it because I'm sure y'all...
First Psalm?
No, it's Psalms. I mean Samuel, I'm sorry, let me read it. Samuel first. The word of Yahweh came to Samuel. I regret having made Saul king.
Mm. Wow. My Lord.
For he has turned away from me and has not carried out my orders. Then Samuel was deeply moved, and all night long he cried out to Yahweh. Now remember, we are not talking about God as a man sitting down with Samuel over a cup of coffee and a Krispy Kreme donut saying, you know, Samuel, Saul sure did let me down. What Saul had when first anointed, he lost it. He did not carry out my orders. He came up with his own orders and turned away from God's orders.
All right. Mm-hmm.
God's promise was an unchanging promise.
Mm-hmm.
Oppressed by the Egyptians, the covenant did not change. Oppressed by the Babylonians, the covenant did not change. Oppressed by the Assyrians, God's covenant did not change. Oppressed by the Greeks, God's covenant still did not change. Mm-hmm. Oppressed even by the Romans, God's covenant did not change. Oppressed by the United States, God's covenant has not changed.
Well,
if God's covenant has not changed, then the only thing preventing this covenant arrangement from being fulfilled is if the people's part of the covenant does not change.
Well,
want to look at the situation that we're talking about in terms of leadership. It's in your handout. It's a list of the kings in the north and the south. And of course, my computer went down. But if you look at that, you'll see what we mean about bad kings and good kings. If you look at all those kings, what do you see? Going down the list, what do you see?
More bad than good.
All right. More bad than good, most definitely. We got a situation.
Bad.
So what does that tell you? It's telling you that 9 times out of 10, you're going to get more bad kings than good ones. So don't be surprised. And more importantly, don't be hoodwinked at the bad king is in control. Just understand that's kind of the way things are. You got good and you got bad, but you got to understand the difference between the two. Scripture says that God told Samuel to anoint David. God is cosmic energy and emanating life force throughout creation. That is our understanding of God here. That means there was no big white man whispering in Samuel's ear saying, "I want to choose David." But rather, Samuel could feel and sense God's spirit in David, and that the aurora surrounding him was positive. Though anointed on the down low as a youth, he was destined to rule. Saul had David playing the harp in his court with no clue he was going to replace him. David's encounter and slaying of Goliath put him at the top in the hearts of the black nation Israel. After Saul's passing, David assumed leadership of the southern kingdom of Israel, called then Judah. Israel, which was in the north, was ruled or led by Absalom, David's son. Sad to say, not only did David have to deal with traditional enemies of the black nation, but he also had to deal with the northern kingdom. The two kingdoms had a continuing and ongoing civil war. However, with the strong leadership and military prowess of David, the northern kingdom is defeated. David unites the two kingdoms, and this is the first time the black nation Israel has united in terms of north and south under the rule of one king. David ruled from about 1009 BCE to 969 BCE. Look again on your, I think it's on the back of your bulletin, and it shows you the kingdoms. Northern and the southern kingdom. And if you look closely, you can see where Jerusalem is in the south, and then up in the north where Absalom is ruling. But basically, this is how Judah and Israel were functioning. Two separate kingdoms, a northern and a southern. But finally, they are united under the rule of David. This time of relative peace was continued into the rule of his successor and son, Solomon. After all of the bloodshed, all the weeping and wailing, we now come to the book of Psalms. I guess you thought we'd never get there. I would like for us to think of this period as the beginning of the Jerusalem Renaissance.
Well,
a time when the black nation Israel took time to enhance their cultural and religious history through song and poetry. David, a key writer but not the sole writer of the book of Psalms, is credited with almost half of the 150 chapters by most scholars.
Well,
we want to think of him as the Smokey Robinson or Curtis Mayfield of his era. Right. Had a good background in playing the harp, so he's musically inclined. So he wrote a number of books, chapters in the Book of Psalms. The Book of Psalms, a collection of hymns and poems used in worship of the temple. It is arranged, as we mentioned in the beginning, into 5 parts. And today we're going to look at some of those areas and try to get a tangible feel for a few of the Psalms contained in this book. We have talked in the past about the Dead Sea Scrolls, y'all remember that, found in the Qumran community.
Mm-hmm.
Many times here in class, the reflection back to the past gives us a greater insight. And so this was the same when the Qumran Scrolls were found, the Dead Sea Scrolls in the Qumran community. Part of the contents in those scrolls found at Qumran were the scrolls of the Psalms.
Mm.
Now, I'll try to go on down. Like I said, I'm slow learning.
There we go.
Okay. Now, all of you that are gifted in Hebrew, one of the scrolls, the Psalm scroll. But if you really knew what you were looking at, also contained in those scrolls is what's called cantillation marks. Cantillation marks that give people basically a rhythm or beat in which the musicians or director of the musicians are to follow. Sheet music, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
And after years and years of studying these cantillation marks, Susan Haki feels that she has fairly and accurately been able to translate the tempo and the key used thousands of years ago during the time of David. Now this has enabled musicians to now recreate some of the Psalms as sung and played in the days of King David.
Mm-hmm.
Now of course there are those that disagree with some of her formulation findings, but we're going to accept her proclamation with this understanding that she is white.
Mm-hmm.
And 9 times out of 10 lost the soul of the beat in her translation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Too bad we didn't have Berry Gordy or the Motown to do that for us.
Well,
but we're going to focus in right now on Psalms 121. And in your book, we're going to do a little choral reading this morning.
All right, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And we want to start off with the sisters. If the sisters would read their part, and then we'll move on down to the brothers.
All right.
Sisters.
I lift my eyes to the mountains. Where is help to come from? Help comes to me from Yahweh, who made heaven and earth.
No letting our footsteps slip. This guard of yours, he does not doze. The guardian of Israel does not doze or sleep.
Yahweh guards you, shades you, with Yahweh at your right hand, sun cannot strike you down by day nor moon at night.
Yahweh guards you from harm. He guards your lives. He guards your leaving, coming back, now and for always.
Amen.
Now let's try to look at it back in the day.
I
morning, so that kind of gives us a little taste of what King David might have been listening to back in his day. Could I get someone to read the next point in the outline?
That's Psalm 27.
Mm-hmm.
Yahweh is my light and my salvation. Whom need I fear? Yahweh is the fortress of my life. Whom should I be afraid?
All right. Thank you, Brother Dwight. Psalms contains a couple. Psalms is also noted, as we stated, for its poetry. There are two recurring forms of poetry found throughout the book. They are synonymous parallelism and antithetic parallelism, for all you English scholars. Psalms 27:1 is an example of synonymous parallelism. And let's see if we can get a little bit of that. Sign for too long. But two basic lines, as we said, that say the same thing in a slightly different way. This type of expression reinforces and reaffirms strongly one's position. I say what I mean and turn around and mean what I say.
Yeah.
A sample of antithetic parallelism. Someone read point four for us. Psalms 1:6.
For Yahweh takes care of the way the virtuous go, but the way of the wicked is doomed.
Well, amen.
In this format in Psalms, it usually spells gloom and doom to the enemies of the nation Israel, or to those of the black nation that are out of step with the will of God. These expressions of God, the praise, the honor, and the prose that comes out of Psalms permeates the religious experience in churches today all over the world. Many times we sing Psalms and quote Psalms without even thinking and understanding that its roots are in the history of the black nation Israel or some other traditional African religion.
Mm-hmm.
When we hear the nationaires sing Psalms 21, Psalms 27:1, we just hear good singing, good moving song.
Well,
but it's good moving ancient African religious singing.
Well,
that is alive and well and strengthening not just us, but people all over the world.
Mm-hmm.
So we heard how that sounds with us today, but it was rooted in our ancestors' past.
Amen.
It's not only in the music of synagogues and churches and cathedrals, it's also borrowed by the secular and used by them to find strength in their life and in their career.
Mm-hmm.
Get someone to read Psalms 144:1 for me. Mm-hmm.
144:1.
Blessed be Yahweh.
Mm-hmm. Blessed be Yahweh, my rock, who trains my hands for war and my fingers for battle.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So who was that? I was just about to play. Y'all got those little things to tell you what the song is before two or three notes?
Shazam.
I which teaches my hands to war and my fingers to fight. Through it all, he's protected me along the way. And I want to thank you. Without you, I'm nothing.
So we see how influential all of these songs are today. Back in the past, there's no way that David or the writers of that phrase could have imagined Keisha Cole would be strumming that beat and making millions of dollars. The section, we want to move to the section of songs that deals with prayers and entreaty. The section dealing with prayers and repentance and entreaty covers the history of various trials and tribulations of the black nation Israel. They highlight the realization of the power of God and how small and fragile we are outside of His will.
Yeah.
The authors plead for personal or group mercy and understanding. Get someone to read Psalms 143, verses 1 through 4.
Lord, hear my prayer. Listen to my cry for mercy and your faithfulness and righteousness. Come to my relief. Do not bring your servant into judgment, for no one living is righteous before you. The enemy pursues me. He crushes me to the ground. He makes me dwell in the darkness, like those long dead. So my spirit grows faint within me. My heart within me is dismayed.
All right, thank you. Now, this is the dilemma one faces when you're outside of the covenant. You know you're wrong, but you don't want to be put on trial. You don't want the group have you to face your weakness. You ask for righteous responses or feedback or constructive criticism, but you really don't mean it. That's why you talk about your group. That's why you talk about them like a dog after the group challenges you to redirect your behavior.
Amen.
You want them to be nice and listen to your pleading. You want them to understand and listen to your litany of rationalizations. The world is pounding you down, destroying your confidence. And you cower in a lack of self-esteem. You hide from your responsibility of building a black nation with power.
Wow.
And all the group is trying to do is get you to better yourself. You, however, want to act like you can reach down and with your own hand you can just throw out some courage, throw out some wisdom, some of anything. But you can't do it. It's impossible. No matter how gifted you are, no matter how blessed you are by God, you will never give of your full potential on your own. It takes a community. It takes a community to dig deep into your soul and release your God-given potential. And why is that? Because you have shortchanged yourself. You think you have given your best, and you don't even know what your best really is until you have been challenged to your limit. And then when you begin to realize with the group's help that there is more of you on the other side of that wall that you thought was the best you had to give. We run around, oh Lord, speak to me. Let me meditate on what it is that you want me to do. Give me direction, give me strength. Let me understand what it's all about, what I have to do. Well, heck, you didn't get the email last week. We just had Kazi yesterday. I was calling and telling you what to do then. Where were you at?
My Lord.
Email connection was down or whatever. Psalms 22, 1 through 8. If I can get someone to read that.
My God, my God. Why have you deserted me?
Hold on, one. Sound familiar?
Yes.
Okay, all right. It's a long time before Jesus got on the cross. Okay, continue.
That's right.
How far from saving me, the words I groan. I call all day, my God, but you never answer. All night long I call, and cannot rest. Yet, Holy One, you who make your home in the praises of Israel, in your fathers, but their trust. They trusted and you received them. They called and you called you for help and they were saved. They never trusted you in vain. Yet here am I, now more warm than man, scorn of mankind, jest of the people. All who see me jeer at me. They toss their heads and sneer. He replied on Yahweh, let Yahweh save him. If Yahweh is his friend, let him rescue him.
Well, I like somebody else who loathed in their life, huh? Don't you feel, though, that that prose is for you, for us, as we struggle together here in the Black Nation?
Yes.
How many times do you think our founder, Jeremoji Abebe Ajanin, must have reflected on those words as he lay down to sleep? After dealing with us and the outside world that was trying to destroy us.
Well.
But when you get up the next day, you get up knowing that God is on our side. And that God and the spirit of your brothers and sisters have been through harder times before.
Well.
So get back in the fight, all you Black Christian nationalists.
Well.
Tell the ref to go on and blow that doggone whistle, and let's start this thing up again.
Well.
That's what it's all about. Can I get someone to read Psalms 122:1? Psalms
122:1. I rejoice when they said to me, let us go to the house of Yahweh.
Well,
yes, very moving psalm. It's a psalm that we sang a lot of times here in the church. And I'm trying to find where I'm supposed to be at. You should go, don't want to stop. Yeah, so let me see if I can get her, or get to the next time. But she ain't gonna stop. But if we look at the song, How I Rejoice When They Said Unto Me, it's basically a song of thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm.
It's talking about all what the Lord has done for you.
Amen. Right.
Psalms is inundated with songs of praise and thanksgiving. Mm-hmm. The various writers, they stress being thankful for what they have accomplished. Many times, the accomplishments that have made them great and made them powerful. But a lot of times, we are so caught up with what is going wrong that we fail to enjoy all that is going right.
Well.
When you joined the shrine of the Black Madonna, that was something going right in your life.
Mm-hmm.
When you sought out brothers and sisters and you brought them to the sacred circle of the Pan-African Orthodox Christian Church, that was something going right in your life.
Mm-hmm.
That was a turning point for those brought in. It was a time, whether they mentioned it or not, that they were glad when we said unto them, let us go into the house of the Lord. That home in the West End, where the Black Madonna stands stately and majestically, welcoming brothers and sisters to the house of the Lord.
Well,
this is a unique house.
That's right.
Nowhere else can you get this message of Black theology and Black liberation.
Mm-hmm.
And it is brought to the world by us.
Well,
that's something to rejoice about.
Amen.
That's something to rejoice for.
Amen.
Go right down here and try to get a little taste, if I can get this stuff to operate correctly, about what it means to be a black Christian nationalist. But today, we also, as Black Christian nationalists, have our own songs. We're writing our own message. We're telling our own story. And it's going to be a story. A story that others. Meditating all day on your law.
Well,
how I have come to love it.
Mm-hmm.
By your commandment ever mine, how much wiser you have made me than my enemies.
Mm-hmm.
The The comprehensive writings of Jeremoji Abebe Ajiman are our guideposts.
Well,
they represent our behavioral interaction with one another,
right.
Our established process of building strong black men and women are an extension of our covenant relation with God of the black nation.
Right.
Rules and regulations of how to rid ourselves of the counterproductive slave lifestyle which destroys us.
Well,
we opened talking about the Qumran community, the location where so many historical documents shine a true light on the real history of the Bible.
Right.
We are going to close briefly talking about the 21st century Qumran community.
Well,
known as the Legacy Community Action Center.
Well,
a storehouse of information of the Black Christian Nationalist movement and Black theology.
Amen.
Documents, tapes, songs, videos, manuals, books that give a real and true insight into what it means to be a member of the Pan-African Orthodox Christian Church.
Well,
they lay dormant just like the Dead Sea Scrolls.
My Lord. My
they
Lord.
They were decaying just like
my
the
Lord.
Dead Sea Scrolls. And just when modern Christianity was about to close the book on the truth of the history of the black nation Israel, the truth came to light.
Well.
And so it is today. Just when confusion and uncertainty was about to rewrite what is black theology.
Well.
And black Christian nationalism.
Well.
Bang. The truth exploded back into the light.
Well.
So if you should wonder, who am I? If you question or if you have theological Alzheimer's starting to set in, go to the Legacy Center.
Well.
Put on some of Jeremoji Abebe Ajiman. Look at some sermons. Read some of the materials, and I guarantee that the black Christian nationalists in you will be singing songs, quoting prose, and reigniting that fire that you had when you first walked down the aisle.
Well.
Amen. Thank you.